A very good afternoon to all of you. I welcome you all to session number 28 of ICF Travel Series Break Free. And our speaker for today is Sudhanshu Verma, who is into cycling, cinematography, and photography of weddings. And he has been on some very interesting journeys. And today he's going to share some of those with us. So over to you, Sudhanshu. You can start with a brief intro of yourself and then you can start your screen sharing.
Hi. Thank you, Vivek, for this wonderful opportunity and Dhruv as well for inviting me to the session and, you know, meeting so many amazing people virtually in these strange times. So hi guys, I'm Sudhanshu Verma. And I am an adventure cyclist, vegan, and I am a photographer and a filmmaker by profession. And it's been 6-7 years of taking bicycle as my moving home and going to remote areas on my bicycle. And since then, I've been exploring a few places up north in Ladakh, few places around Goa. So I've done a couple of tours already on my bicycle, which we will be talking about in my upcoming in this. I'm going to be share about my how I do my tours, what I carry, and a few clips from my tours, and you know, some extraordinary experiences which I had on these journeys. So I would like to share my screen with you all and then start with the presentation. Okay, so I'm going to start with a small video of from my journey, and it will have a few glimpses of what I did on my last trip. So just let me know if it's coming clear, Vivek.
Okay.
Yeah. Vivek, I hope that was visible to all of you.
Yes.
Brilliant, Sudhanshu. Very nice.
Thank you so much, Dhruv sir.
It's you're lucky. You're such a good photographer and a drone artist. You can capture the journey properly.
Yeah, I mean it was a pain to carry all the gear, but then when I saw the end results, I was like, I should carry it always. Okay, so I'll start now.
Yes.
So once again, thank you so much, Dhruv sir and Vivek sir, for giving me an opportunity to speak here.
And I am not the one who gives you the opportunities. Vivek only. Vivek and the copywriter, it is for him. I'm a guest like you, yeah.
No. I think you all deserve that. So thanks a lot. And with this, I would welcome all of you to the non-competitive side of cycling. And you know, in our country, in India, most of the times when I take till the time I got into serious cycling and, you know, keep doing it every day and things, I get to listen about the competitive side of cycling a lot. Like, you know, people just talk about how many kilometers you did, what was the speed, what record did you break, are you cycling this long, is there any record you're making? So these were the questions which I usually still get from people who you know, see me doing these things, and they just want to talk about the technical sides of it, you know, the records and data. But I am totally on the non-competitive side of cycling. There is still a competition though, but it's majorly with me inside and maybe with the mountains to go higher, to go to these remote areas. So let's start with this side of cycling and share more about how I do it and what I do. So we'll start with how I started bikepacking and also how I got into cycling. It's kind of an interesting story because, you know, as a kid, I was always driven by outdoors sports. And I remember I was in my school and I used to cycle from my house to the stadium, which was 7 kilometers. And come back and then again go to the school, which was again 7 kilometers, play there. And I used to then come back and again go for my football practice around 4:30 p.m. And then come back late at night. So every day I would, you know, cycle 35 to 40 kilometers. And this used to be my daily schedule, like for cycling. So cycling and staying outdoors and active was always with me from the childhood. And whenever I got the opportunity to, you know, to be outdoors and to play something, you know, I used to play cricket. Then I got into professional football career, and then now, you know, just totally out of it and got into cycling as a non-competitive sport. So I think back in 2016 is when I got the hang of you know, traveling, and that's when I found out that there are people who travel by foot, by bicycle, by car, and there are some crazy ones who likes to hitchhike to places, and they like to go to different remote areas. They like to go and explore the world on you know, with bare minimum, and you know, with taking these risks and just go out there and explore. So a quick introduction, guys. Again, hi, I am Sudhanshu Verma, an adventure cyclist and a co-founder of Our Slug Life, which is essentially a bike packing bag making company now. And I've been a photographer and a cinematographer since 2013, specialized into covering weddings. And an adventurer soul, because I just can't live in you know, in just one place. I like to you know, go to these remote areas and just explore the wilderness and just be on my own. And that itch has been with me since 2016. So you know, there was a time, I think in 2016, when I kind of watched this movie called Into the Wild. And the first time I watched it, I was like, how can somebody travel without money and things? And I just found that movie so inspiring. And I felt, you know, if a guy like him can move through places and meet so many amazing people, why can't I do it? So I watched that movie for like a couple of days again and again and again. And I found the meaning of like the movie every time to be different. Sometimes it was as projected, the happiness is only real when shared. And sometimes it was like, you know, how to live in a very minimalistic way and do what you want to without these materials and just be out there, meet people, and you know, like get absorb this vast experience which you get from outdoor world. So in 2016, I remember I was planning to buy a MacBook and I was saving some money. And I watched this movie and it's like, chuck MacBook, I don't want a MacBook. Let's plan a hitchhike tour from Jaipur to Kanyakumari. So while I was planning this Jaipur to Kanyakumari hitchhike, I found this guy, Mohit, and he was, you know, riding. He rode his bike from Kashmir to Kanyakumari. I was like, wow, if this whole thing can be done on a bicycle, that would be like amazing, because I will be able to carry so much on my bicycle and I'll be able to move on my own speed. And rather being dependent on vehicles, I would be happy to just bicycle through villages, stop wherever I want to. So I was saving that money and I thought, you know, let's use that money into bicycle. So I bought a bicycle, and within a week, with the help of, you know, people, the local cycling community, I started cycling, and I just within a week I left for the first solo bicycle expedition from Jaipur to Kanyakumari. I really had no experience of traveling. I had no idea what I will face. Even fixing a puncture or a chain was totally new to me. And I remember on my very first day, when I camped at Sambar Lake, there were 3 punctures in my tire, and that was like I think the toughest day of that journey which I did. And you know, I was carrying so much gear, and it would normally take me around 2 to 3 hours to pack things on my bike every day, because they were so heavy, and I was carrying so many things: my tent, sleeping bag, camera, whatnot. So you know, it was like a moving home, and I could see that, you know, I had all the luxuries to live on the road and survive. So I was just going with the flow. I remember on my second day, when I reached a place called Kishangarh, my dad with an army guy, they both came, and they were like, they tried their best to stop me from going further. And I was like, it's something I want to do, and it's something I want to explore on my own. I was so pumped, and I just told my dad, it's going to be late, you should head back. So, you know, I was so crazy about this tour in 2016, and I think this tour kind of completely changed my perspective towards human beings. I used to be I was very scared of people, and I used to, you know, shy away, or I used to just stay away from people. And this tour kind of removed that barrier, because there were cases in which people would just come and ask for chai, ask for money. They would give me money like without even telling their names, and they would invite me for dinner. And I never knew that this thing could happen, you know, like, and there were so many amazing people I met on this journey. People would, you know, ride with me for kilometers on at the speed of the bicycle, and they would just keep asking me, please stop somewhere, I'll want to give you chai, I want to make you drink tea from my money. Or they would, you know, stop and give me money and say, just keep doing what you're doing. And I would say, I don't want money, and they will say, when you reach this temple, just donate it there. So like, I was so stunned that, you know, people hardly cared about the money, and hardly cared about all those barriers I had in my brain. And it was just a life transformation which happened on that journey. You know, I remember how I used to make my food. I used to I was carrying masala oats for my breakfast, peanut butter for my lunch, and dinner used to be always, you know, with God's grace, I think it used to be always by somebody's hosting me, or I used to find something. So I remember I used to go to these chai walas, these thadis, and I used to wait for a chai wala to make his tea. Then I used to ask him, bhaiya, let me wash your vessels, and then I will prepare my oats, and again I will wash it and I'll give it back to you. So, you know, I would wait for him to complete his customer thing, and then I will wash his vessel, make tea in it, and I'll give it. And he would not charge me any money, rather he would make a tea for me also. So, you know, such experiences were there, and I used to go and ask fruit vendors for fruit which they won't sell, because I was on a very limited budget. So I used to go and ask for fruits, and I used to try my best to stay grounded, stay low, so that I can survive longer and longer on this journey. And since then, you know, in 2016 when I did this, I realized I was not very, there were parts of journeys on which I felt why I did this, why I was doing, the questions came to my brain. And I kind of realized through the end of the journey that I don't want to be on the highways more. So I thought I want to go next to somewhere in north. And I was so sure that I think I don't want to do tours like these in which I'm just riding on highways. Rather, I want to go, you know, places where there is less human connection, and then there are like secluded villages where cars are not still able to reach, or like, you know, some very remote areas on the bicycle. So in 2017, again, I planned a route from Manali to Pangi Valley Sach Pass, which is known as one of the world's dangerous roads in you know, because it's very rough terrain, and you, even the villagers, even the locals are not very open to drive through this route. So I remember people, villagers, locals were, you know, telling me not to go by this route because the rocks keep falling from the cliff and it's kind of dangerous. But I really made it through this, and then amazing experiences over there, you know, the people I met, and so many adventurous parts. And then in 2018, I did, this was the first time I found out that there is a valley called Zanskar in Ladakh, and which was still not connected by roads. So, you know, that was one of the driving force. And I was like, I want to go to this place because firstly, it will be an amazing experience to connect with these people living there. And then I got to know that in few years, the roads will start building and it will be connected. And now it's actually, the project has just been developed so much. Now people can actually drive all the way to Zanskar. So I was lucky enough to, you know, travel to Zanskar by Shinkula Pass, which is around 5,000 meters. So the journey starts from Manali, and it takes you through villages like Sisu in Lahore Valley. Then you basically reach a place called Darcha. And from Darcha, you basically go towards very remote areas like Chika Rarik village. And then you have to climb a pass called Shinkula Pass. And in 2018, I was with a friend and we both were doing this together. And when I, you know, got to the pass, and it takes another day, it takes full day to reach the pass, and another day to get down from the pass and reach to a place called Karyak, which is a village. And when I reached there, you know, I found out that there is, luckily there was a satellite phone in the whole village. And so I kind of, you know, requested them that I will pay whatever you want, just let me call my family so that I can update them. And, you know, when I called them, the first thing they said was that I have to rush back immediately because my grandfather was not well. So 2018, I, you know, the attempt to complete the Zanskar Valley was not completed because I again walked back for 2 days back to this Shinkula Pass. And it took me almost of 2 days by crossing rivers, and I reach to this pass Shinkula, where I found somebody dropping few foreigners, so I could hitchhike with them back to the civilization, and I was able to get back to Jaipur in time. So in 2018, again, you know, I again went back to Leh to complete some sections of my trip, which were again still left incomplete because of my health condition. I was able to, you know, I was in Leh and I was feeling better. So I started riding towards Khardungla. I remember, I think it was that moment when I kind of felt that first time in my life, I was giving back to Mother Nature, because I actually when I was riding up, I kind of started picking up plastic all the way to Leh, which is like the highest motorable pass in India. And that to me, it was very positive and it was very, inspiring, because I always, like, we humans are kind of consumers. So when I would stop to pick up the plastic, I would just cry simply because I was like filled with joy. And I was like, wow, this is something which I want to do in my life, and I want to give back to the community, to the Mother Nature. So in 2018, after that, in 2019, again, there were some parts of Zanskar which were left. So I again was itching to go there, and I again, planned a route. I'm not going much in detail about 16, 17, 18, what I did there, because there are like so many amazing stories which I can share, but they'll take like long. So I'll get to the fresh memories I have of 2019, and I would share from those stories more, because it was the most recent trip I did. So there were two parts of this journey. I think one was when I went from Manali to Zanskar, and one was from Zanskar, I again did a very remote route from Surajtal, which is a lake, and to Chandratal in Spiti. So since 2016, I have believed and I've learned that it's not the places which have been my driving force. I think it's the people and the culture which keeps calling me to these places. And I can now proudly say that I have families in all these places I have been to, and there is a kind of connection which calls me to meet them every year and see them and interact with them. So in 2019, I was in Manali, and I was thinking that which way shall I go? Shall I go towards Spiti, where I hardly know anyone? And should I go towards Zanskar again, where I know a few people, and even in Lahore Valley, which I know, I know a few families I know there. So I started riding towards Rohtang Pass. And after Rohtang Pass, you have to decide. You either can go towards this side or the Spiti side. So again, I listened to the call of the people, and I started riding with the intention of meeting these people. So I stayed with the families in Lahore. I again met people in Keelong, then Darsha, then I stayed with the families in Shikararek. Then again, after Shinkula, when I entered Zanskar, again, I met a lot of people whom I knew. So, it was like, when I got to, there was a village in Kargyak in Zanskar, and I reached there, and I met Zul Lobsangji there. So I was thinking of returning from there, and Lobsangji said, now you have come till here, go meet my sister who is in Tangtse, which Tangtse is the next village. So I was like, okay, fine, I'll go meet them. So in Tangtse, his sister says, I have a cousin in a village called Purne. You should go stay with them. So I started riding another 25, 30 kilometers in the mountains deep inside to go there. When I reached Purne, they said, you should go to Phuktar Gompa and see the prayer there, and you should see the monastery and meet the lamas there. So I hiked all the way to Phuktar Gompa. You can see these are some of the people I have met. The first picture here, it's this family I've always stayed with in Lahore Valley, and we are still in touch. This is a family in Chikararek, and this is Lobsangji in Kargyak. Similarly, these experiences and these people have always made me travel and explore these areas with me. Obviously, the places are so beautiful that you want to be there, but these people actually make them memorable for you. So again, this this picture on the right it was clicked at a village called Rumse. I was attempting to do a section from Rumse to Somoruri Lake. There is a trail which also used to be called as the salt route for Ladakhi people. They used to carry salt from Somoruri Lake back to Leh via this route. So I was attempting to do it. I could not because I had some health problems in 2018. And this is a small kid which I, you know, I while I was photographing in the village, I found him interesting in Kargyak village, Zanskar. This is a monastery which I was talking about. It's in Ladakh, Zanskar Valley. Quite remote, you cannot go by a vehicle. You just can only reach by hiking. And in winters, basically the river, Zanskar River, you know, when it's frozen, these lamas get their goods from villages, from rivers, and you know, it's very interesting to see them do that. And this monastery is called Phuktar Gompa. These are some you know, something, some parts of my journeys. Like, you know, I usually have these vessels and stuff with me, and my morning is normally you know, granola and oats and lots of things which I carry with me to eat. So you know, since 2016, I think there was always this notion, or there was always this feeling in my head that, you know, if I do these things as a non-competitive sport, and I'm totally like towards you know, towards taking cycling as something which brings joy to me. And over years, like from past few years, I've realized that there are times when you have to be prepared, and for cases in which if something goes wrong, you need to be able to, you know, bring yourself alive out of those situations. And over the years, kind of I've evolved through my first tour to this tour in which I'm going to talk about now, which I did in 2019 with a friend, Mohit. And so, you know, from the beginning of my tours, you know, I was very careless. I would never plan these things. You know, my Jaipur to Kanyakumari tour, I didn't plan anything. I was just going with the flow. I didn't plan my budget. I didn't plan my stays. I didn't plan my route. I didn't plan what I'm going to do. And like in 2017, I started planning a little bit. In 2018, I did some more planning. I bought gear according to the things. I bought stuff. I bought food with me. I planned my budget. And now 2019, you know, because of that transition from moving from 16 to these so many years, I kind of realized that how I evolved over every tour to be able to pull out this rescue mission which happened on the journey with Mohit. So basically, if there is a place called Darcha in Ladakh, and basically if you want to reach to Manali from Darcha, you can take either the highway, which is, I think, the easiest way out. And that's how the truck also goes, the highway via Rohtang Pass. Or there is a horse trail which connects these two places called Baralacha Pass, where Suraj Tal is, and Chandra Tal in Spiti Valley. And then you can, you know, climb Rohtang Pass and reach Manali. So I happened to meet Mohit in Darcha, and we both decided to do a small section, do this trail from Baralacha to Chandra Tal. And I remember, you know, when we entered into the valley, we both were completely fine. We both were absolutely enjoying every bit of it. And there were no signs of any, you know, any situation in which we got into later on. Mohit's health was fine, my health was fine. So this route usually takes 5 to 6 days to traverse from Surastal to Chandratal. And if I remember, I think you have to cross at least 6 to 7 times, I think 6 rivers on the way. So we thought these rivers will be manageable, and we started our journey. And on the maps, it showed that there will be a descent as per altitude, and we kept on going. So I think on the third day, while we were crossing the river, I remember, that was a long river, and I am a guy who doesn't know swimming, and I get scared of water. So I was very scared when I saw the river crossing, because it was huge. And when it comes to lifting a bicycle, and when it comes to lifting my bike and crossing the river. So I looked towards Mohit and I asked him, Mohit, from where shall we cross this river? And the moment I looked at him, he had actually already crossed half of the river. So I was like so shocked that, how can he do it? And I was like, I was not even able to, decide from where should I do it. So then he went there, and I told him, Mohit, I won't be able to do this alone. So I had a rope, luckily. So we, I tied the rope on my waist, and then he helped me to pull myself. So on the way, I think on the midway, when I was crossing the river, I fell in the river. So luckily the rope was there, and he saved my life there. And that companionship between us started to grow on these occasions, and he would help me wherever I needed help, and I would help him wherever he needed help. So these are some kind of terrains. You can see we were passing through very challenging and rough terrains. So on fourth day, Mohit started developing symptoms of AMS, and AMS is altitude mountain sickness, and he was not having cerebral one. He was having AMS in his lungs. So basically whatever he was having, even the water, food, everything was coming out. So it was a kind of a scary situation for me. So I remember that evening when, Mohit was not even able to stand and walk like 100 meters. And we had to cover a lot of distance with the bike. So I found one place where, I made him rest. I took his bicycle, I dragged his bicycle, and I just thought that maybe next morning he'll be fine and we can leave again. And, that night was the scariest night I ever had in my life, because I never planned for it. I never planned that something like this could happen on an adventure, So at night, I remember his tent and his sleeping bag failed because of the wind and the cold. So he was actually sleeping inside my sleeping bag, and I was sleeping over him so that he stays warm and he could make, he could survive the night without any trouble. And next morning I, simply woke up and I asked, Mohit, can you walk? Can you breathe? And he just said, I won't make it, and you just do your best and go try to get help. So I started, packed some of the gear and I started running towards Chandratal, which was still 17 kilometers from where I had, camped in the village. And then I rushed to the village. I think I started by 6:30 a.m., got there by 2:30 p.m. and gathered, I met these three, I met this family from Lahore. They were having their lunch by Chandratal Lake. So I met them and I just met them and I started crying, because after 3-4 days, I saw a few humans and I was so so overwhelmed that I could not stop my tears. So they kind of asked me if there was something wrong. So they helped me get to the Chandrata Lake and gather 9 people, which you can see in the photo right now. We made a stretcher for Mohit to bring him back, and we all hiked back around 5 p.m. The same evening, and we got we reached to that camp spot, which was 17 kilometers up into the valley by 2 a.m. So you know, whole day I was trekking to get the rescue operation done, and then collecting these guys, and then again you know, go back to Mohit because he was alone there, and you know, kind of make it back with Mohit. So luckily these gentlemen, these guys from Chandratal Association, they all came and they helped Mohit. And you know, I think this was a big learning for me, and this is how I evolved through these journeys, which I did, that something like this can also happen, and you have to be more planned, and you have to really be prepared for these kind of sports. I mean, yes, it's kind of like a non-competitive side of cycling, obviously, but then I realized that, you know, the planning plays an important part in these journeys as well. So I just want to share a few things about what is bikepacking, and I'll keep it short. Like, you know, my definition of bikepacking is simply take your bike where people hike. You know, it can be horse trails, it can be any kind of terrain other than, you know, paved roads. It can be mixed terrain as well. And you know, it's just beyond cycling, because you carry minimal gear, and you have you know, it's like a moving home, because you have all your luxuries you can have to live on the trail, and you have the freedom to go anywhere you like with this kind of setup. This is the view from Shinkula Pass going towards Zanskar. This is some of the gear which I had on my first bikepacking trip. My tent, my sleeping bag, bottles, my you know, nutrition is there, everything. This all was supposed to be fit on this bike, and yes, you can all do all that. So you know, few things which you need for your adventure was bikepacking bike. You need storage on your bike, like bags and stuff. Then you need sleeping gear, like sleeping bags, tent, mattress. And then you need, if you are dependent on yourself, then you need to also take care of your food. So I carry all my camp kitchen, which is a stove and, you know, utensils. This is how I pack my bike. My handlebar bag looks like this. There's a frame bag, there's a seat pack, there's a top tube bag. And this is an example of sleeping gear. You know, everything is available in India at Decathlon. This is a mat, ground sheet, ultralight sleeping bag, because everything needs to be very minimal. So I carry things which are, you know, easy to pack and can be packed as small as possible. Then these are some of the stuffs which I've used and I still use. You can always reach out to me if you want to know more about these companies and stuff. So this is one Chinese stuff which I was using on one of my tour. And this stuff actually failed. And since then, I've never been using any Chinese products, because, you know, I remember I was carrying food for 5 to 6 days in this remote region where I was doing room set to Somuri Lake. And on the pass, I stopped to make something for myself, and I realized the stuff has stopped working, and because of some issue with the fuel line. So I had to retrieve and get back and, you know, abandon the whole expedition because of this. So always prefer a good company for these equipments. This is what I wear when I'm doing bike packing. Mostly, you know, it's mostly dependent on the weather. When there is cold weather, I like to layer up and stay warm. There are different kind of layers you can choose. And in warm weather, I always suggest to get you know, things like which are quick dry and easy to wash. And sometimes I do carry bamboo cotton t-shirts, which are you know, which doesn't stink when you're sweating much. So this is also a good option. Just to share what I eat and what you can also carry if you're doing things like these. You know, I carry peanut butter, plant-based granola bars, oats, noodles, protein powder so that I can recover overnight. Quinoa is there, and you know, Sampa is a superfood which is available in most of the Ladakhi regions. And you know, monks, when they travel by foot for many days, they always have Sampa to survive. So Sampa can be mixed, it's like a powder, you can mix it in chai, you can make butter out of it. So many things are possible, and it's a superfood. So if you are there, please do get it. I carry spices and sugar, some dry fruits, vitamin C tablets. I always talk about how to travel responsibly, because you know, it's not like we are entering our zone, we are entering other species zones, and we have to respect other species as well. And being a vegan, I make sure I don't yeah, Dhruv, you're saying something? Okay, so you know, being a vegan, I try to respect wildlife as much as possible. And this is a way, you know, people sometimes ask me, how do you poop in the wild? And this is a clear illustration, I can say, is to explain how do you poop in the wild. And I stick to this almost 70 to 80% of the time. There are times when you won't be able to find a place where you can dig a hole. So it's not always important that you dig a 6 to 8 inch hole, but sometimes just trying your best is also important. So I now plan ahead and prepare how I'm going to do these things so that, you know, I'm not stuck, and I can, you know, just, don't leave my, you know, trash behind and carry these things back. I hope, Vivek, it was, you know, a good presentation.
Yeah, it was an interesting and engrossing presentation, and the rescue mission stories were very good. I would say they gave us goosebumps, and I would say that you and maybe both of you were lucky that you were traveling together, because once they saved you and later you saved me.
Thanks everyone. Thanks to all the participants. See you next week at 4 p.m.